Let's bring in my panel for this evening, Sky News hosts James Morrow and Caleb Bond. Hi to you both. Thank you very much for joining us this evening.
Pleasure to be here.
Caleb, let's start with the government's misinformation push. I mean, surely it is not some Canberra bureaucrat's job who is sitting in their office, in their air-conditioned office, to tell us what we should be thinking and how we should think. What do you think?
Well, correct. There are two problems here. The first is that they are using two tragic events to essentially push their misinformation, disinformation agenda, which has been going on for more than a year now. And the ultimate goal of that is to control the information that media outlets and individuals and social media companies can publish online. They want to decide via ACMA, the media authority, what is and isn't the truth. Mm-hmm. Now, when the government starts becoming the arbiter of the truth, you ought to be worried, because that's what they do in communist regimes. Mm-hmm. It's not up to the government to tell you what is and isn't real. And the other problem is the idea that this vision should not be allowed to be seen or shared in any way. Because the vision is not misinformation or disinformation.
No.
The vision is simply what happened, whether that be from the alleged terror attack in Sydney on Monday or what happened at Bondi Junction. Now, I've always taken the view that if there's a piece of vision that within the various codes we have to adhere to, mm-hmm. most of which are self-imposed media industry codes,
yes.
that we should show that to viewers and or readers.
Yeah.
If Facebook, Twitter or X as it now is, I tend to believe they are publishers, mm-hmm. they should be able to make editorial decisions mm-hmm. about what they do or do not allow on their platforms. Mm-hmm. And if they want to allow that vision, that is their decision. It's not up to the government to tell them whether they can or cannot.
I completely agree with you. It's not up to a bureaucrat. And how would they even know? Who gets to make that decision? James, we've seen this happening all around the world, as I just mentioned in my editorial there. Are you worried that Australia is now facing the same fate when it comes to censorship?
Absolutely, Danica. Look, this is a huge worry because we are seeing this happen all over the world. We're seeing this in Ireland. We're seeing this in Canada. We're seeing this in parts of Europe. We're seeing this very shockingly in Brazil, which has gone very far down this road in a really sinister way. And there have been huge demonstrations against that judge and against the government in part because of this. This thing here, you can see exactly how the government, the Labor government, alighted on this. You know, they had a big problem. They had this big incident with the alleged terror attack on this bishop. And they suddenly said, this causes us a lot of problems because people are going to be talking about things like social cohesion, alleged Islamic radicalization, integration, multiculturalism. All things that the government doesn't want people talking about, particularly in the wake of the Israel-Hamas war and the electoral calculations that they've got going on in Western Sydney and in other suburbs of the country. So they say, oh, well, hang on, Elon Musk, he's the real villain here. And let's get everybody here talking about Musk and how they let this piece of vision out there, which, as you said, is not misinformation. This actually happened. And so, you know, let's call that misinformation. Let's say that's to blame here, not other sorts of issues which people might start talking about, and have the bonus that then once you start down this road, God knows what people can talk about. I mean, we've seen this with COVID. We've seen this mm-hmm. in other countries with issues around transgender issues. We could see it yes. around climate change. We could see it with all sorts of things. This is a very dangerous road to be going down, Danica. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely, and you're right. Where does it end? How long is a piece of string? I mean, this is when it starts, you don't know where it ends. Now, look, it's been a bad day for the Albanese government after two new polls showing more and more voters are deserting the party. In the Australian's latest news poll survey, Peter Dutton is shrinking the gap on the Better PM poll, increasing a point from 34 to 35%, while Anthony Albanese's remained unchanged on 48%. And even the Sydney Morning Herald's Resolve political monitor, it found the Labor's primary vote has reduced to 30% from 32%, while support for the coalition increased from 35 to 36. Caleb, Albo seems to be really struggling to convert support for his policies into political points. How do you read it?
Well, look, I mean, the results we saw from the polls today are marginal, mm-hmm. might we say. There's no massive movement and things could well change in a year's time when we're probably looking at another election. I've always taken the view that there will be an election called as soon as interest rates start to come down, and it will be an election run on the platform of, you know, we've put in the hard yards, we've got inflation down, interest rates are starting to come back down again. We need your support to finish the job. You know, we've made it this far. Come on, let's see it through, which is essentially what Bob Hawke ran on for his second term in the 1980s. I still suspect that will be the case. It just depends on when exactly we get those interest rate cuts. But when you look at the polling you had before Christmas and before New Year, which actually showed the coalition edging ahead in terms of the two-party preferred, that has softened a bit, but it's not softened to the point where the Prime Minister would be or should be confident that he has an election win on the cards when he goes to an election. I don't suspect that they are staring down the barrel of a loss, but what they are very much looking at is minority government. And then you start talking about, well, do we go into to power with the Greens? Do we go into power with the Teals?
Oh, goodness. You know,
we know what happened in 2010, and that did ultimately spell the end of the government after that term. But it could be interesting and dangerous times.
Look, that's a fair point. As James, as Caleb said, OK, a minor change here, but how much pressure does it put Labor under, particularly ahead of the May budget?
Well, look, the May budget is not going to wind up, I think, with anything particularly huge. We've already been warned about that, not to expect any sort of huge, reforming programs or huge big spends there. And, you know, this is actually reflective of the fact that, well, you know, not only budgets rarely actually move the needle very much for government one way or the other because everything's dropped out before the budget is handed down. But beyond that, though, you know, the issue here, Caleb is correct about the sort of the electoral mass there, but, you know, beyond the fact that interest rates likely aren't going to come down as quickly as people think, you know, if you look at what's happening in the United States, there's very little appetite, I think, on the part of the Fed and Janet Yellen, who I think wanted to get those rates down before their election in November, to do that, given inflation stickiness there and around the world. But the other issue, too, really is that we are seeing the problem that this is not a government of big ideas. It was a government elected largely on a protest vote against the coalition and Scott Morrison. And they had one big idea, which was The Voice, which fell over. Now they're saying things like, oh, well, made in Australia. How does that sound? How does that sound to you? That sounds really good. But what does that mean? Well, it seems to mean at this point, shoveling a lot of money towards non-competitive industries to prop up renewables investors. So, you know, we need something bigger, I think, to see this through.
Yeah, and I feel like that's going to be the slogan as we head into another election. Or we're just going to hear about the future made in Australia. It's going to drive us all nuts. But look, in another blow to Labor, mining magnate Gina Rinehart says the Chinese Communist Party is doing a better job than our government. In a keynote address, she said which country's government understands the importance of reliable electricity production and is building many coal-fired power stations and nuclear ones. Caleb, she's got a point here.
She does. Look, I'm sure many people in China would disagree that their government does a better job for them than ours does. But Mrs. Rinehart has a very valid point about, you know, look, it's easy to run a government when you're a communist regime because you don't have an opposition and you don't have to deal with the day-to-day politics in that sense. But China is a country very much like India that acknowledges that it has a large poor population and the only way to maintain the confidence of those people is to pull those people out of poverty. And the best way to pull those people out of poverty is with industry, and the only way to have industry is with cheap power. China, India, etc., and much of the third world doesn't give a rip about whether or not they're putting emissions out into the atmosphere.
No, correct.
What they care about is making sure that they have an economy that is turning over and is producing stuff for their people. Meanwhile, we here in Australia and the rest of the West, you know, we would much rather self-flagellate and actually do ourselves in while the rest of the world is powering ahead. And we go, look at us, we're 1% of the world's emissions and we're going to cut ourselves off at the knees and have nothing, except we're now going to build wind turbines or something.
Well, that's apparently, all right, isn't it?
Made in Australia.
wind turbines.
Which no one's going to buy because they're too bloody expensive because they're made in Australia.
Exactly.
And the ones that are made in China with our coal are the ones that we'll be buying.
Look, make sense. I think you've just put that absolutely perfectly, Caleb Bond. James, do you think that Gina Rinehart has a point here?
Yeah, look, I think Gina Rinehart has a very big point here. The fact of the matter is that we are an energy-rich nation. We should have reliable and cheap energy, abundant energy, to drive our industries. And yet we don't. And we see this in our power bills, and we see this in what's going to happen with our renewables transition. And, you know, what I'm concerned about, just to bounce off of what Gina Rinehart said about China versus Australia, you know, my concern is if you look at other countries like Germany, which have essentially deindustrialized and you know, have huge energy problems and where their economy is going. And then you look at China and the state of their social control. I'm worried that, guys, we're going to wind up in Australia with the worst of both worlds. We're going to wind up with Chinese social media control and a German economy.
I think you've absolutely... Look, the both of you have said it perfectly tonight. James Morrow, Caleb Bond, thank you so much for joining me this evening.